Hey, I'm Stephen, and this is Solving the Money Problem. If you're new, awesome. If you're not, also awesome. Let's talk about Elon Musk. Musk is a brilliant engineer with an atoms-up understanding of physics. This first principles approach to problem solving permeates the cultures of both SpaceX and Tesla. If you're unaware, Elon Musk is the chief engineer and designer at SpaceX. Yes, he literally designs rockets. Yes, the impossible ones that can now land themselves for rapid reusability. The same rockets that everyone mocks SpaceX for attempting to create, those ones. The reason SpaceX have been able to do what previously not even entire nations could do is because of great engineers who have found new, far more efficient ways of doing things. Both Tesla and SpaceX are ruthlessly resourceful and have ingrained cultures of finding new efficiencies and perpetual optimization. It's a never-ending process to get more out of less. Tesla has a culture of optimization on every level, driven by an army of the world's best engineers who are guided by an incredibly resourceful CEO. And the optimization isn't confined to physical things. The business itself is being endlessly optimized as new efficiencies are found. From an investor's point of view, this gets me very excited. Doing more with less is a recipe for ongoing success and improved profitability. So let's look at Tesla, the optimization machine, and what it means for Tesla's future and its stock price. Corporate structure. Elon Musk is a walking logic machine. Screw convention and what others think. Does it make sense? Is it right? Then do it. Not giving a shit what others think and not living a life of convention can rub people the wrong way, hinder interpersonal relationships, and encourage unwarranted input from others. But none of this matters. What matters is doing what makes sense, not what's conventional or what other people think you should do. Question everything appears to be Elon Musk's motto, and he's worked diligently to ensure Tesla is a lean, efficient machine. Here's what Elon Musk has said on meetings.
And one thing we have at the companies is we try to minimize the size of meetings. I think it's actually important to minimize the size of meetings.
So what would be a normal size? How many people would you typically have in one of your meetings?
Normal meeting would be 4 to 6. But the basic rule for the meetings is that unless somebody's getting enormous value from the information they're receiving or they're contributing to the meeting itself, they should not be there. And we also have a rule that if somebody's in a meeting and finds that this meeting is not helping them in a meaningful way and they are not contributing to the meeting, they should just leave.
Just get up and pack.
Just get up and walk out.
All right. Would that be, in your culture, would that be rude to do that?
Or? No, that's expected.
That's
rude to stay.
we may be able to go a little further.
Meetings can be the biggest time sink ever. We had some collaboration programs with other companies where we would have 6 people in the meeting and they would have, I don't know, 30 people in the meeting.
Ah, now we're starting to sound like some of the meetings I'm used to.
Yeah, it's a frequent problem, and they really don't like it when people get up and walk out either.
Yeah.
He's serious. It's actually expected. It's a negative thing if you're just sitting there and not contributing and kind of on your phone or on your laptop in the corner of the meeting. You know, there's so many groups like that, and it's just no one's engaged and it's not productive.
In short, if you're not getting or adding incredible value in a meeting, get the f*** out. This email from Musk sent Tesla-wide is also telling. Subject: communication within Tesla. There are 2 schools of thought about how information should flow within companies. By far, the most common way is chain of command, which means that you always flow communication through your manager. The problem with this approach is that, while it serves to enhance the power of the manager, it fails to serve the company. Instead of a problem getting solved quickly, where a person in one department talks to a person in another department and makes the right thing happen, people are forced to talk to their manager, who talks to their manager, who talks to the manager in another department, who talks to someone on his team. Then the information has to flow back the other way again. This is incredibly dumb. Any manager who allows this to happen, let alone encourage it, will soon find themselves working at another company. No kidding. Anyone at Tesla can and should email/talk to anyone else according to what they think is the fastest way to solve a problem for the benefit of the whole company. You can talk to your manager's manager without permission. You can talk directly to a VP in another department. You can talk to me. You can talk to anyone without anyone else's permission. Moreover, you should consider yourself obligated to do so until the right thing happens. The point here is not random chit-chat, but rather ensuring that we execute ultra-fast and well. We obviously cannot compete with the big car companies in size, so we must do so with intelligence and agility. One final point is that managers should work hard to ensure that they are not creating silos within the company that create an us versus them mentality or impede communication in any way. This is unfortunately a natural tendency and needs to be actively fought. How can it possibly help Tesla for departments to erect barriers between themselves or see their success as relative within the company instead of collective? We are all in the same boat. Always view yourself as working for the good of the company and never your department. Thanks, Elon. So basically, at Tesla, do not waste time doing dumb shit, and when a problem arises, solve it by taking the most direct course of action. This may sound obvious and simple, but the fact is, most companies don't do this and suffer death by a thousand small cuts. Over time, this no BS corporate culture has delivered amazing results, and Tesla is just getting started. The cars, aka hardware and software. Have you noticed? Teslas keep getting better. A Tesla is basically an iPhone on wheels. Software is eating the world, and Tesla has brilliant software engineers who are finding ways to increase performance, range, acceleration, braking, and add new features and functions like Sentry Mode, Dog Mode, Netflix, Karaoke, Smart Summon, and plenty more. All after the fact and delivered with over-the-air updates. Customers who buy a Tesla find their car gets better with age. This is insane, but it's reality. How other automakers will compete with this, I do not know. They haven't even figured out how to do over-the-air updates, while Tesla continues to make their vehicles better every few weeks. Tesla is also optimizing the hardware in the vehicles, continually deleting parts and processes.
It's a lot of little things, like looking at each little tiny part, each process, say, is the process necessary? Like, because the best part is no part, best part of the process is no process. And occasionally at the design level, you think something's necessary, but then it turns out it's not. So it's just like making sure, connecting between design and manufacturing, make sure we close the loop on that. Just saying like, hey, it's a lot of real simple stuff, but it's like times a thousand.
A look at Tesla's patents gives a lot away. The new wiring system Tesla has invented will save material costs, labor, and weight, which will improve range, increase margins, and save time. No other automaker has bothered to invent something like this, and it's just one of the countless examples of Tesla finding new efficiencies in their vehicles and new ways of doing things. Tesla's super bottle is another prime example. Basically, Tesla has found a way to combine two pumps, a heat exchanger, and a coolant control valve within a single component, saving loads of space, weight, complexity, time, and cost. No other automaker would do this. No other automaker could, because different departments don't talk to each other. They exist in silos. Something like this could only ever fly at Tesla, which is why this super bottle is a Tesla innovation, not a GM or Ford innovation. Every time Tesla finds a new way to save money, time, or weight in its vehicle, the optimization machine rolls on and the new efficiency propagates quickly throughout the company. Tesla doesn't wait for a new model year to introduce improvements. When they're ready, they go into production. Again, this makes sense. Why withhold great features and put yourself behind the eight ball when you can instead drop new features immediately and retain your lead? There's loads of other examples, but let's keep it simple. Tesla keeps finding ways to optimize their hardware and software. This matters. Tesla's marketing department. Here's a crazy idea. Instead of spending billions of dollars trying to convince people your product is great, why not just make a great product? I know, crazy idea. Tesla has done exactly this. They do not pay for advertising or endorsements because they don't need to. Their products are so good, they sell themselves. To date, Tesla has sold almost 1 million vehicles and built an enthusiastic army of millions of part-time, unpaid, volunteer Tesla marketers and salespeople. As I've said, the more Teslas Tesla sells, the more Teslas Tesla sells. And then we have Elon Musk's Twitter. In an instant, with the press of a button, Tesla can broadcast information to a following larger than the population of Australia, for free. No other automaker can do likewise. This matters. The machine that makes the machine. Elon Musk has, for many years, emphasized that the factory itself, the machine that makes the machine, is the real product, and it's at least 1 to 2 orders of magnitude more difficult to design than a vehicle. Gigafactories are where Tesla's optimization machine is in full force. We know Tesla bit off more than they could chew by trying to over-automate Model 3 production in the US, resulting in delays, pain, and many levels of hell. But that doesn't mean it was a bad idea. It was just too much, too soon. When a company is innovating and scaling so fast, they're bound to make mistakes. If you're not breaking things, you're moving too slow. Tesla learns very fast. The Shanghai Gigafactory is the most pure example of this. In less than a year, Gigafactory 3 went from muddy field to volume production. What's startling about this is that it was built for 65% less capex per unit of capacity than the US Model 3 production lines. A 10 or 20% reduction would have been very impressive. A 65% reduction is crazy. And then there's the epic Model Y frame casting machine, which will turn 70 parts and processes into one. This is extreme optimization, and yet Tesla isn't done. They'll never be done. They continue to innovate, optimize, and find new efficiencies. It's in their DNA. Over time, incremental improvements compound into staggering results. A bunch of 0.5% improvements may not seem like much, but imagine finding 10 of these improvements every year for a decade. In 10 years, you're doing almost twice as much with the same resources, nearly a doubling in efficiency just from a consistent long-term optimization. This matters. I've speculated that in the future, Tesla will license or sell their gigafactories to other automakers or partner with them because nobody is making EVs as efficiently or profitably as Tesla. Why is this? Because nobody else has been optimizing their hardware, software, organization, and production techniques as aggressively as Tesla. Tesla has always said they can't compete with other automakers on size, so they have to compete with them on intelligence and agility. And we're seeing this play out. Tesla has proven they can go from muddy field to delivery of immaculate, volume-produced, profitable electric vehicles in less than 1 year. Meanwhile, most other automakers aren't even at the starting line. They can't get their software or production right. They can't deliver on their range promises. I mean, customers don't even want to buy their cars because they kind of suck. In 2020, most automotive manufacturers are not where Tesla was a decade ago, and Tesla is not standing still. This matters. Making electric vehicles is not the same as making internal combustion engines. Not only is Tesla in the lead by a massive margin, but they continue to squeeze more out of less and find new efficiencies at every level of the company. In my opinion, Tesla's lead will only grow further. Legacy automakers are screwed. Their competitive advantage, the internal combustion engine, is now a liability. Expert combustion engine engineers are not expert battery engineers. Turning around a big ship is slow and painful. It's going to be a bloodbath. The writing is on the wall. The most critical and costly component of an electric vehicle is its battery. Tesla's lead in battery technology is embarrassing, and their recent acquisition of Maxwell Technologies and Hybar Systems strongly suggests Tesla is extending their already 5-plus year lead further. If Tesla was optimizing just battery technology, or just corporate structure, or just factories, or just its hardware, they'd be a serious force. But Tesla is finding new efficiencies everywhere, and they're not stopping. The Tesla we see today, at this very moment, is the most inefficient, least optimized, most cumbersome, dumbest Tesla we'll ever see. That is a scary proposition, and one that makes me very happy to be a shareholder. I'm Stephen Mark Ryan, this is Solving the Money Problem, and I love you all. Thanks so much for watching. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Do you agree or disagree with any points? Have you noticed the same optimizations? What other ways is Tesla finding new efficiencies? Are other companies doing the same? And of course, if you have any ideas for future videos, let me know. I read all your comments. P.S. If you're still watching, you're awesome. This channel has kind of blown up since it launched, and I'm working on making the best possible content for you guys, but it takes time. Consider supporting the channel at patreon.com/solvingthemoneyproblem. So I can continue creating content for you guys. There's a link in the description. Either way, the best kind of support is you being here and watching, so thanks again.